lecture series. I'm Curtis Manning, an associate professor of history at the college. And I have to say, over these 10 years, I've been getting a little nostalgic, especially in this 10th season, kind of looking back on things. And I know I see a lot of the people in the audience that have been with us almost the whole time. But as a historian, I like those concrete facts and statistics to prove how long it's been. All right, so just as a quick overview, I double-checked. We, including special lectures, we had 82 lectures in the series with 9,036 attendees, sometimes counting more than one, so about 110 per lecture. And during that whole time, one of the most amazing statistics is that there's only been one time where the lecturer didn't show up when they were supposed to at the last minute. And so what I never can say that. I have a colleague who knows all about greed and gets on to me when I say stuff like that without knocking on wood or those things. But also one of the best topics that we've never had before but have been asked and asked is tonight's topic on the history of voodoo. So I'm thinking we'll have an expert on greed and things like that. So maybe I won't get punished next time if the speaker doesn't show up or whatever. Also, yeah, and I'm hoping that that our lecture tonight, I hope to be historical, of course, on voodoo, but I also want some practical information on how to use it and things like that, but we'll see that going. And then as far as a visual history, for those of you who've been around for a while, you know, and the others, that we've had a mascot of the history lecture series, and we started this about seven, eight seasons ago, and the first appearance by the mascots, she wore this. As you can see, it's monogrammed with the New Century Lecture Series. And it's been a little while because of agents and other activities and all that kind of stuff. But I finally negotiated a reappearance of the mascot. And so to mark the time, I'd like to welcome Chloe Manning to the stage. I tried to get her to wear this, but she wasn't for some reason. I don't know why. All right, so. Okay. All right. And just as a disclaimer, choosing Chloe had nothing to do with her being my daughter and me being a very proud father. Had nothing to do with that whatsoever. Purely on merit. All right, so. All right, so for tonight's speaker, I'm very excited to introduce Dr. Ina Fandrich, who holds a Master's of Divinity from the University of Hamburg, Germany, and an MA and a PhD from Temple University in Philadelphia. Also, she's a licensed tour guide in the city of New Orleans. For more than 20 years, she has taught courses in religious studies, anthropology, women's studies, gender studies, African and African American studies at many institutions throughout the United States, including Temple, South Dakota State, Rutgers, Swarthmore, and LSU. She's the author of the book, The Mysterious Voodoo Queen, Marie Laveaux, A Study of Powerful Female Leadership in 19th Century New Orleans, and as well as numerous articles. She has lectured in New Orleans, on New Orleans and Louisiana African American history and Creole culture nationally and internationally, providing over 40 presentations at professional gatherings. Her research has been featured on CNN, NPR, as well as in the Times-Picayune, the Chicago Tribune, and the New York Times. And as kind of a research scholar myself, or that I like to be more so than the other kind of history, I was very, very impressed when I was reading up on her and found out that she discovered the birth certificate of Marie Laveaux, which is, if you've ever spent any time in dusty archives, especially for me anyway, with other languages and that kind of thing, it's an amazing, amazing accomplishment for way back when. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Fandrich.
Good evening, everyone. Can you all hear me? Good. Okay. All right. Well, Uh-huh. Oh, wait. Let's go back. Okay. The topic, is there any way of getting this light out of my way because I can't see anyone? That's better. Okay. Alright, well, voodoo in New Orleans is kind of a controversial topic, as you all know. I called it voodoo on the bayou because there are other voodoo traditions in the world, in West Africa and in the Caribbean, and they do not have bayous. In West Africa, the climate is different, and in Haiti, they have high mountains. So we don't have high mountains. So it's voodoo on the bayou, Marie Laveaux and New Orleans voodoo tradition. Now, if we think of New Orleans culture, we think, of course, of food, right? That's the first thing.
Yeah.
We think of music, that's the next thing, you know, music. We all love our music. And we think of voodoo. All of these 3 points have been heavily influenced by the African population, because since 1719, New Orleans was started to be built in 1718. But right the next year, in 1719, we had many boats coming from West Africa who brought these enslaved people from the west coast of Africa, who actually had a lot of history, a lot of culture, and a lot of knowledge. And our culture here has been heavily, heavily, heavily Africanized ever since. Our spices, we always say that we have Cajun food here, but you know, when you go to Nova Scotia or to New Brunswick in Canada, their food doesn't look anything like ours. No hot spices. So who uses the hot spices? The Africans do. Why is this not moving? Aha. Right. Okay. So in this lecture, something is not so good with this technology. let's call upon Papa Ogu, right? He is exactly. I just to mention his name, Papa Ogu is the voodoo spirit that rules all technology. He's the god of iron and war. Alright, so what I want to accomplish here today with you is look into what is voodoo, why has voodoo such a terribly negative reputation, who was Marie Laveaux, what do we know about New Orleans voodoo tradition, what I call voodoo on the bayou. So what do we know? Number one, what is voodoo? Well, when we think of voodoo, well, that's what we think of. We think of a thick cypress swamps with Spanish moss everywhere and a thicket, and somewhere in there lives a voodoo priestess. Aha! Okay, this is Marie Laveaux, the great voodoo queen, and our songs actually remember her, that she didn't study with another voodoo priest, but she studied with Vieux Crocodile, which is of course the alligator. So she studied in the swamps, and the animals in the swampland, especially the alligators, were telling her how what to do as a voodoo priestess. Now, when we think of voodoo, we always think of certain stereotypes, right? And we always have the same one. We think of evil people that gather at night, somebody died, you have a, you know, a skull somewhere, we have a snake somewhere, we certainly have some animal that has to die, some rooster's head will roll, and alcohol is in abundance. So we all have these stereotypes. This is actually from the Louisiana Historical Quarterly, from the index under V, and the first thing that shows up is voodoo. So, and it kind of shows what we think of voodoo. This is another one from the Jim Crow era that shows, you know, here she dances, the priest dances with a crocodile, and everyone is kind of semi-drunk or crazy, and here somebody passes out. So those are kind of our stereotypes, that it's evil, some blood is gonna run, people look like crazy, they don't even look human, you know. They dance with a snake or a crocodile, and something terrible is gonna happen out there. Always crimes and stuff.
Yeah.
the next thing we know about voodoo is this, of course, right? This is the famous coffin charm that's very famous for New Orleans, that you can magically, with putting such a charm on somebody's doorstep, you can kill the person inside, you know? Yeah, so that's another thing. It's evil, of course, whatever charm you find somewhere, that's gonna be bad. Now, the surprise comes, when we go to the next one. Voodoo has absolutely nothing to do with any of that. Etymologically, voodoo is derived from the term vodu, which means divine spirit or God in the Fon and Ewe languages, what's today's Benin, Togo, and Ghana. That's where voodoo comes from. And in the People's Republic of Benin, this country here, the former kingdom of Dahomey, even today, voodoo is their main acknowledged religion. So 9 out of 10 Americans, when asked what voodoo is, believe it to be a particularly evil form of witchcraft. So how do we get from that? You know, how do we get from divine spirit and God to evil witchcraft? And you all know that, right? Ooh, voodoo, bad. So instead, it's not a form of witchcraft. It's a cluster of mystical bona fide religions that have their origin in ancient Africa. In fact, people think voodoo to be more than 10,000 years old. And the more I got into it, I have to tell you a little bit about myself. I'm biblically trained. I studied theology for 7 years. So I had that as a background. And then I came to the United States and started getting involved in world religions, but especially in the African-based religions. And it's very interesting, much of what voodoo people do is exactly what the people did at the time of Jesus and earlier in Israel. So they offer animal sacrifices, but it's only the blood that gets offered to the spirit. So, and that's what Mary did after she gave birth to Jesus. She went to the temple and sacrificed a dove, and I don't know what else, but read it, it's really interesting. It opened for me a really new window to have access to the actual literal text in the Bible, to be involved with these ancient African religions. So we have several types of voodoo. Voodoo is a cluster of religions, I told you. And they're all kind of summarized under the strange name of V-O-O-D-O-O. The first one is not spelled V-O-O-D-O-O. It's usually spelled V-O-D-U-N, Vodun, or Vodun. And that's the official religion of the People's Republic of Benin. So that's a traditional West African religion. The next one is Vodou, and that's in Haiti. Now, Vodou in Haiti is, of course, a combination of many African religions. Haiti had a high concentration in the 18th century of people from Africa. Their plantations were so horrible that people had a life expectancy of only 3 to 5 years after they arrived in the boats from West Africa. So they had to be constantly replaced. So Saint-Domingue, which later became Haiti after the revolution, had a very high concentration of people born anywhere on the west coast of Africa. But 40% of them came from Benin, and that's where the word came from. Interestingly, also in New Orleans, from these 5 first boats, one of them also came from Benin. And so from the very beginning, from 1719, we had that word here, voodoo, for African spirits. Now our number three is, of course, voodoo. In the French, spelled it V-O-U-D-O-U in the 19th century. So consistently in all the newspapers and all the texts in the 19th century, it was not spelled V-O-O-D-O-O, but V. O-U-D-O-U, so Laveaux' religion was Vodou in the French way, V-O-U-D-O-U. But with the Anglicization in the 20th century, during the Jim Crow era, we don't find the first version anymore. So today it's V-O-O-D-O-O, and that's what pretty much everybody uses right now in New Orleans. Then we have another version of voodoo, but it's synonymous with hoodoo, H-O-O-D-O-O. Is not the same as our New Orleans voodoo. Hoodoo are all the magical practices of African Americans throughout the South. And they are quite diverse. Of course, New Orleans is most famous for its mojo charms, but they have them everywhere where you have a significant African-American population. So it's just the Old South of the United States and their magical practices. They also exist in the Protestant context, not only in the Catholic one. Finally, of course, we have voodoo in Hollywood, you know, and that's what we usually see. Like, for instance, anyone has seen Angel Heart with Robert De Niro as the devil? You've seen that, right? So everything evil that's connected with him is in New Orleans. Actually, the novel on which it's based never had any scenes from New Orleans, but Hollywood just liked New Orleans with all the voodoo in there. So then you had it. So now let's have a look at where it comes from. So we have here Nigeria, this is the Bay of Benin, and here is the People's Republic of Benin. There's neighboring Togo and there's Ghana. So this region here is where voodoo comes from. However, in New Orleans, we also get a huge population from this area, especially from Senegal and Mali, from the Senegal and the Niger River Basin, especially the Senegal River Basin. And they had a huge influence on us. Then the other big region that had both an influence on Haiti and especially on New Orleans and Marie Laveaux was this area here, the Greater Congo Kingdom. It's three nations today, it used to be just one. We have here Zaire, Angola, and Congo Brazzaville. These three nations used to be one big kingdom. And we had one boat also coming from here, from the port of Cabinda. So we did have a Congo influence already during the French. But then in our Spanish colonial era, between, you know, in the 1760s till 1803, we were under Spanish rule, we got mainly people from the Congo. So our original African population was about 80% from Bambara people, from this region here. And under the Spanish colonial era, a little bit later, we got mainly Congolese from this area. So, and they had a huge influence on us, on this African spiritual tradition that merged with popular Catholicism in New Orleans. It's a little bit different from the Haitian tradition. It developed parallel. People said that our voodoo came from Haiti, not true. We already had a voodoo tradition that was well in life here 100 years before the Haitians came. Most of our Haitian immigrants came in 1809 when New Orleans doubled with 10,000 people from Haiti. But we had already a very developed African tradition, African spiritual tradition here in New Orleans. Let's see. In fact, the key term that everybody associates with voodoo in New Orleans, Gwigwi, comes actually not from anywhere else but from the Mande people in the Senegambian region, the Bambara people. It comes from charm. It comes from the Mande word for charm. So here we have, can you all see this? Because this light is kind of strong. Can you dim this light a little bit more, please? Because this is a bit graphic. We don't have kids here. Oh yeah, we have a few here. Okay. All right, well, this is a sacrifice. The blood, this is only the blood after the animal dies. And it's actually a very, it's an easy way for the animal to die. The animal, it does not suffer a lot. It's very fast. And this is still the way that in Judaism, animals have to be killed to be kosher, and this is still the way how Muslims kill an animal to be halal. So this is an old way of, a religious way of killing an animal. And this animal is not wasted. Believe me, in Africa very often only the ritual food is the only meat they eat in month. So this everything is used. It's just the blood that goes to the spirits. So this is from Benin. Okay, here is a spirit possession. Can you dim this lid a little bit more? Sorry. we have one characteristic of all African-based religion is spirit mediumship. And in this form of spirit mediumship, people get mounted by a spirit entity. So the conscience of the priest, or the priestess in this case, is gone. And instead, this highly developed priestess, because you have to be spiritually evolved in order to allow a spirit entity to mount you, has become now the goddess Mami Wata. And she's now mounted by the mermaid spirit, the goddess of the sea, Mami Wata, and now can divine the community. So when people who didn't know anything about voodoo thought they passed out because of alcohol, that's not true. They were passing out because of, they were not passing out, they were mounted by a spirit. Here you see her, this is again a priestess being mounted by the spirit of Mami Wata, very important. That's the female power in West Africa, Mami Wata. Here we have the Dagbo Hununhuna, the last Dagbo. His son has taken over, but this is the old Dagbo who is considered the Pope of Voodoo, like the highest priest in the Voodoo world. He was a very highly developed spiritual person who was close friends with the Dalai Lama and other spiritual leaders in the world. And he came once to New Orleans, actually. So some of the local voodoo stores here have a personal connection with him. So his image you'll find on many priests, on priestesses' altar. Here we have the pythons. Marie Laveaux is said to have danced with the pythons. In Benin, you have a sacred python shrine. Mami Wata dances with a python. Pythons are sacred throughout Africa. So in many countries in Africa, you have rituals around snakes. Here we have the python priest from the python temple. Here we have a child being blessed by the python. Pythons do not bite, you know. They kill their prey by strangulating them. But a small one like this would never attack a baby like that. It's very safe. It looks so dangerous, but it's very safe. There's really no concern. But what this represents is that the child will be blessed with the power of the python god and Mami Wata. So it's a blessing. Here again, women bring their children to get blessed. Here we have different depiction of Mami Wata. This is an ancient Egyptian one. This is a statue of Mami Wata. And it looks, you know, strikingly similar of how Marie Laveaux sometimes was depicted, you know, as dancing with a snake. And here is one statue that has been fed. What it means to feed a statue is that blood came on it and some of the feathers of the sacrificial animals. So this is to make this icon, which is just an icon, to charge it up more spiritually. It just intensifies the presence of Mami Wata. They do not pray to the icon, they pray to the energy of Mami Wata. Like Catholics do, they don't pray to icons, they pray to the energy, the sacred energy behind. So most voodoo practitioners in the world, in the new world, I should say, here in the Western Hemisphere, are devout members of the Roman Catholic Church. That's another little known secret. In fact, in Haiti, nobody would even think of initiating you unless you are a good Roman Catholic. And here we have the island of Haiti. This is the western part of the island of Hispaniola, where Christopher Columbus first landed, and the Taino people found him and discovered him at the shore. So Haiti has his Taino name again. The French called it Saint-Domingue, because Santo Domingo is, you know, the other part of the island, now the Dominican Republic. And Haiti in French, or in Taino, means land without mountains. The whole island sits on a fault, and you know what happened just recently, right? The major earthquake. So these mountains are there because of the fault, but of course we also have the earthquakes there. So many of our New Orleans people from Haiti were from Les Cayes, from Jacmel, and from the south in general. They then went, or Jeremy, they then went from this area to Cuba, and from, yeah, Cuba, and then from the eastern part of Cuba, they came to New Orleans. But I told you, they came later. Originally, we already had a voodoo tradition. So this is just, we have to think more of Haitian voodoo as a sister religion than the mother religion of our voodoo tradition. Now here we have a voodoo temple. This is a voodoo temple. It looks kind of familiar, right? We have here the Virgin Mary We have all kind of goodies here, you know, for on a Laveaux altar. And here we have something we are familiar with, right? It looks exactly the same. This is a St. Joseph's altar, right? Exactly the same. So you see the Catholicism is very, very similar, and it's very much from a similar tradition. We all know what St. Joseph eats, right? He eats fish, he eats crabs, he doesn't eat meat. We never find on St. Joseph's altar anything. I said he doesn't eat. Well, we are, you know, we are familiar with him, but it's very similar in the so-called Voodoo tradition. So here we have all the offerings on the St. Joseph's altar that we know so well. Our fava beans, the mojo beans. And here we have two ladies. We have on this side an Italian American who can proudly embrace this shrine. Here we have an African American lady. If she builds something almost identical, suddenly, woo, evil, witchcraft. What happens here? So why does Voodoo have such a horrible negative reputation? We find our answer in the transatlantic slave trade. If you do what they did to a people and justify the whole abduction of whole areas in Africa with the idea that they weren't Christians and therefore you can do whatever you want to them, you cannot at the same time say that their religion was a great one, their philosophy was awesome, and their history was just fantastic. It's not possible. So the transatlantic slave trade in the New World and the New World system of slave labor was justified by Christian ideology. White Christian moral superiority versus African heathen inferiority. Alright? So not only the physical bodies of the kidnapped Africans who were, you know, enslaved, but also their culture and their religions were enslaved. So these lucrative New World plantation industries were based on the complete brutal dehumanization of the enslaved African workforce. Okay? So that's like key for that. We have come to terms that it's no good to hurt these people, to abuse them and not to pay them. But we have yet to come to terms that it's also not good to say that they don't have any religion worthwhile and they don't have any philosophy worthwhile. You know, we are familiar with this. People were branded like cattle, or, you know, marched in these slave scaffolds. It's just unbelievable what was done to them. So here we have Haiti. They arrived there, and you have the mountains, of course. And here we have New Orleans. This is a slave auction that took place in the St. Louis Hotel, which is still there. The Rotunda still exists. It's now the hotel right next to the Supreme Court on St. Louis and Boyle. So in Haiti and in New Orleans, Voodoo was born under the trauma of the transatlantic slave trade as an assertion of resistance against the white supremacist plantation system. Voodoo is a hybrid, blending African, European, and Native American religious traditions. Like all of our religions are, because the Easter Bunny is not in the Bible. Nia is the Christian. Santa Claus, the Christmas tree, right? Those are pre-Christian European pagan traditions. And they are okay. But if it's a pre-Christian African tradition, woo, it's evil. So the successful Haitian slave revolution, that was another thing that made us think about Africa bad. So the successful revolution and their war of independence, which defeated the then strongest army in the world, which was the Napoleonic army, sent shockwaves everywhere in the New World. You know, these African workers defeated Napoleon. So, and now, white people were dying, and they lost, of course, their investment, and Haiti became the first independent black republic. And they paid bitterly. They still, to this day, by the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, which they were not at the beginning. Before the revolution, Haiti was the richest nation in the world, but only for 10% of the population who was the slave owners. So after the Haitian Voodoo the Haitian revolution, voodoo became really, really associated with everything bad. Because before, everything African was considered just, you know, harmless Negro superstitions. But now, after that, they fear voodoo. So, since voodoo empowered the Haitians to overcome their oppressors, these religious practices were now to be considered as life-threatening, you know, and very, very, very bad. So, Haiti was burning, all the plantations, all the wealth burned. And here in New Orleans, the Haitian former planters introduced the same rigorous sugar plantation. We had hardly much of sugar plantations before the Haitian planters arrived. But from the 1790s on, we then had these sugar plantations coming up everywhere. And they kind of are very, very dangerous for the people who work in them and very lucrative for the New Orleans economy. So after the Louisiana Purchase, the New Orleans economy was built on not paying Africans to build sugar south of Baton Rouge and to cultivate cotton and picking cotton north of Baton Rouge. And of course, inventions like the cotton gin and the sugar granulations and also the steamboat helped, of course, the industrialization of all of that next. Okay, so what do we know about New Orleans voodoo tradition, voodoo on the bayou, next. Everyone thinks of voodoo and Congo Square, right? These are the famous dances in Congo Square. It's called the Bambula. It's actually from 1885, this famous drawing, made from memory, because we don't really have good drawings from when these dances actually took place. It took place every Sunday afternoon from the colonial era on all the way until the end of the Civil War. And anything interesting in New Orleans is associated with these voodoo dances, so-called voodoo dances. But as far as we know, what happened in Congo Square was primarily a social affair. Of course, in Haitian voodoo and in any voodoo and any African traditions, rhythms are what is making a spirit come. So it's very much like quantum physics, like our cell phones work, and that's like all of our TV works, that everything exists as a vibration, as a wave, and also it can manifest materially, right? Back there, the projector projects this up here. So the same idea is about the voodoo spirit. When you drown the energy of the vibration of the spirit manifests. So even if they had social gatherings, spirit possessions could happen, but they were not intended or were wanted. So next, please. Voodoo ceremonies took place usually in secret remote places. Like this is another drawing from the same time. So here we have, it's actually stereotypical. The idea was that a mulatta, a free woman of color, would be the queen who presides over the horrible voodoo scene where those people are gathered. These people are dancing, there's the traditional African instruments, and this is what's called a parterre, an altar on the floor. Marie Laveaux is said to have one of those ceremonies every Friday evening in her house, but they probably look more like, next slide please. You see here, this is very racially integrated. Each time when any one of these voodoo ceremonies were raided, let's go back. Each time they were raided, we had white people involved in it. So especially white ladies liked the voodoo religion a lot better than their own Catholic traditions. My suspicion is voodoo was in the 19th century before the Civil War, 90% a women's religion. And I guess it was very empowering for the ladies. So white ladies always looked for being included in that. And a few times a white lady got caught in one of those raids in the 1850s, and the next day her husband committed suicide because he could not bear that his wife was involved in this. So, next. Of course, the great queen, Marie Laveaux, is the one we all know and we all love. So she was, of course, at the heart of everything voodoo in New Orleans. In fact, in New Orleans, voodoo and her name is sometimes synonymously. So she was quite a lady, actually. She was born free. Both of her parents already gained freedom. In fact, her grandmothers already became free. So she could have gone the other way. She had a half-sister with the very same name who could read and write, and a father who owned quite a lot of property, who was a freeman of color. So she could have gone the other way and be super French and super white, but she did not. She embraced her African culture. She's described in the archives as a mulatta, one half black, half one half white, and so are both of her parents described. So the myth that her father was a great planter and her mom a slave is not true. The myth goes back one generation. It's true for the grandparents. It's not true for the parents. So who was Mumilombo? Some of the sources say that was the most powerful woman there is. So people, the oral history said she was the most powerful woman there is. And let's go back one more time to the image before. Oops. No, back. There we go. Here we see she has this beautiful scarf on this image. This hangs in the cabildo. The original is lost, we only have the copy left, and that's where the mystery is, whether it's really authentic or not. If it really, if ever the original reappears and it turns out to be the cat, and then it's true, this is actually then an authentic depiction of how she really looked. So we're still looking for the original that disappeared from the archives of the cabildo in the 1940s. But this scarf has a story. They say that one story says that it was from the Emperor of China sent to her. Another one says it was the Queen of England who sent it to her. And this lore goes that she did work for them, and that was kind of a thank you present. Well, every myth has its true core. So I assume that people. Famous people, nobility, and state representatives also came to consult with her, and that's where the stories come from. Because we know that all kind of politicians showed up with her. She was a very gifted psychic who the rumor went up and down the world, and anything she would predict would come through. So of course everybody wanted to have something from her. Next. All right, so then we also find in Robert Tylan's second book, in his first book he says, oh, she was the most powerful woman there is. In the second one he says, oh, she was the last great American witch, since, of course, the Salem witches. Well, first of all, the witches of Salem were no witches. They were innocent people who were accused of witchcraft because of some religious disputes and a conflict in the community. And second of all, Marilla wasn't a witch either. She was a good Catholic. She was baptized 6 days after she was born, and she went to church every morning for Holy Communion. So here we go, which is probably not the right term for her. So what do we know about her? There's the famous birth record that made the news, that made the other national news even. But you know, I had looked for records on her for 20 years when I finally found that one. But it took me 15 years to identify it because it didn't have no last names. Free people of color and enslaved people were in the archives of St. Louis Cathedral only mentioned by first name. And that's why I first never knew whether I would find it at all. But then within a bracket of 15 years, there was only one person that matched. So I actually could find her. I was very surprised when I did. And it all matched then, so you know all the other data then fell in place. So I have about 5 corroborating evidence. It's definitely her birthday. She married a man named Jacques Paris, or Jacques Paris, or Santiago Paris, because they translated everything then, in St. Louis Cathedral, and that was the data that everybody knew. And they said she was married when she was 25 years old, but that actually was the marriage to her second husband, and that's where the myth comes from. So still now in many historical books, they take 25 years off and then place her birth in the late 18th century, into the 1790s, because they subtract 25 from this one, not thinking that her family actually, because all the descendants of her were the children of this second marriage. So that's why she was actually 25 years old. The myth is true, but it's not this marriage, it's that one, and this one is not in the books. Now, why is the second marriage not in the books? This one didn't last very long. He disappeared, and of course, already then they said, "Ooh, what did she do? She probably put something in his gumbo, some voodoo, and he died, and then she buried him maybe in the backyard or something, you know, or maybe she made him disappear, you know, maybe he just turned into a frog or something, you know." So rumors went already up and down town when he disappeared. But he may just have been a drunk and just didn't find his way home anymore and died somewhere in the street, we don't know. De facto, he was declared dead very soon, already by 1823, and she mourned, you know, like the custom was, wear black for a day in the year, and then she found number two. Number two she knew probably all her life because he lived not far from her, and this gentleman, although the oral history identifies him as white, no, as black, they say he was also a freeman of color and fought in the Battle of New Orleans with the free people of color. Well, no, when I did research, he was of pure French nobility. But he loved Marie Laveaux, and they lived in one household until he died in 1855. So by February 2nd, 1827, we have the birth of their first child, Marie Eucharist Laveaux. Then we have, by 1832, we have the family moving into the home of, on St. Anne Street, which was the headquarters of all things voodoo. It's very close to the intersection between St. Anne and Rampart Street, and thus just across the street from Congo Square. And the municipal jail, which is now the site of the municipal auditorium. Next. So here we have the birth of the last daughter, March 6, 1836. And her name is Marie Philomène Laveaux. So we have here a Marie that was called Marie Laveaux II, and here we have a Marie Laveaux II. So we have two of them. Now, interestingly, next, when Laveaux died in 1855, Marie Laveaux died in 1896. Let's go back one more time. Now, this lady here, we have her death, the second Marie Laveaux. We have her death, she's buried in that famous family tomb. And finally, because we don't have her death record, all the people put those two ladies into one. They just say, oh, this is Marie Laveaux too. And they always say her birth year and her death year. Funny, huh? But actually, we don't know whether the famous Marie Laveaux II that was a notorious voodoo queen ever existed. We do know that the first one existed, and she established all the myths about the great voodoo queen. So next, please. That's the document I told you. That's her birth record. It's in Spanish. And it says Maria Mulata Libre. Now, you know, who would have known that this is Marie Laveaux? It really took a long time. But just like the myth, the story said, it was Father Pierre Antoine, Father Antonio de Sedea, which we all know, whom we all know as Pierre Antoine, the famous priest. He was the priest, he was also the godfather, and the godmother was the grandmother. So this, and Margarita Libre, Mulata Libre was the mother. So we don't have the dad here, we only have the mom, which makes sense, because dad was about to marry somebody else. And mom had a relationship with a white gentleman with whom she had children before and after. So this had to happen fast, and it did. 5 days after she was born, 6 days, she was born on the 10th, and the baptismal record and birth record happened on the 16th. Next. Here we have our Père Antoine, the one and only. When he died, he laid in state for 6 days, and New Orleans never wanted to let him go. They even caused a schism with the bishop just to have their priest whom they loved so much. The next, please. Here we have her ancestry. Marie Laveaux is the daughter of Charles Laveaux, a freeman of color, and of Marguerite d'Arcantin. We have her parents, and we also have his parents. We have Marie Laveaux, a woman probably from the Congo. I have yet to find proof, but there's a lot of there's hints to it, but I still have not found the definite proof. We do have all the ancestors on this side. And Charles Laveaux Trudeau, Laveaux is the middle name, he's better known as Don Carlos Trudeau, and he was the surveyor under the Spanish crown, and then the first president of the city council of the Romans after the purchase. So very important politician. So again, there were a lot of myths that Marie Laveaux, I spelled it here with an X because the family always spelled it with an X. Today it's more common to spell it without the X, but that really only happened after her death that people spelled it without the X. So the stories go that a very famous politician was the father, but it was not the father, it was the grandfather of Marie Laveaux, who probably knew her. Her maternal grandmother was one of those marchands, a market woman, and statistically, among the free people of color, a large population were the free women of color, actually 60% of the free people of color were women, and also 60% of the enslaved population in the city were women because of the urban economy. And many of these market women got their freedom fairly easily because they could work for themselves besides working for their master next. This is Don Carlos, the grandfather. And here we have Native Americans. I could not prove that Marie Laveaux has any Native American ancestry, but the stories go she does. What I could see is that she has, there's a lot of archival evidence, that she has very close spiritual connections with them. A lot of Native Americans stayed in her house when they went to the market on the weekend. They came from the bayou, down the Carondelet Canal, got off on the basin, you know, where now Basin Street is, and walked down a block and stayed with Marie Laveaux before the next day they went to the market. So she got the freshest herbs from the bayou, she got all the animals, everything, all the ingredients that she needed for whatever medicinal purposes and spiritual purposes, she got it from her friends. So it was less blood ties as it was spiritual ties. Here we have the colonial city, shortly before she was born. And here's the cemetery, here's where now Congo Square is, Fort St. Ferdinand before. And one more time back. Here we have the bayou went all the way down here. There was a branch from the bayou. So the Indian Portage, which is now Bayou Road, went from down here all the way there. And actually along this street were the oldest land grants. And the Clapham family lived off Bayou Road, right outside of the city. And at some point, Marie Laveaux must have lived there too during her youth. So she must have known Christophe all her life. Next, please. Here we have the first marriage, and there, because it was, they were both free people of color, we do have a record. This is Santiago's Paris, Jack Paris' signature. There's Charles Laveaux's signature, and he spells it with an X. So Marie Laveaux herself couldn't write, but he could, and so did her sister and a few other relatives. So definitely the family would have spelled it with an X. Next. Here is her mark. She could never write, but she signed it with an X, and the notary said with an X again. One more time back. Widow Paris. After he died, she called herself the Widow Paris because her half-sister had the same name, Marie Laveaux, but she was the wife of a Haitian named Auguste, François Auguste. So they always put the marriage next. Here we have the 1830s census, and that's interesting. We have here the Widow Paris, and she's listed as white, and so is he. In every following census, they're both listed as black. So apparently they wanted to be together, although legally they could not have an official marriage certificate. They might have gotten an informal blessing from parent one, we don't know. But we know that in the 1830s, before the economy went down and everything was great, like there was a crash of the economy in 1837, but prior to then, free people of color apparently were quite easily passing for white. They both could pass for white. Here's the old house on St. Anne Street, which was torn down in 1903. It doesn't exist anymore. Next. The city of New Orleans boomed throughout Marie Laveaux's lifetime. We saw that little colonial place before, around the time when she was born, was right here. Three decades later, when she was in her 30s, this was the second largest city of the United States and the largest seaport that even surpassed in terms of export the New York City next. This is by 1849, so this would be, you know, when she was in her prime years. Next. Here we have where she lived. Here's Congo Square, surrounded by houses. There's the Carondelet Basin. Here's the municipal jail. This would be right where about the municipal auditorium is now. And Marie Laveaux lived right here. So she could walk across Rampart Street. The cathedral would be down here somewhere. So she would go in the morning on Sundays first to the cathedral, then come home, get changed, and then charm the police that wouldn't let free people in because everybody knew her. She would hypnotize and go here and dance, have a good time. All right, so that was her place. Also, you know, she would go a lot to the cemetery. She felt in charge of the spirits, you know, like if we have ghosts in Romans, what's a ghost? A ghost is a spirit that didn't make it into heaven or the abode of the ancestors. So it's somebody that whose spirit is unhappy or lingers around and hurts people. So for her, it was important that people would have a good transition. So she prayed with the people on death row. She prayed with the people who were dying of illnesses. She was a fever nurse. She also tried to help save their lives, but if she couldn't save their lives, she would make sure that they die peacefully and you know, she had a spiritual obligation. And that's why she was best friends with Pierre Antoine, and they often administered to the dying people during these epidemics. And you know, it takes courage when some disease comes that could kill everyone, including the free people of color, but she was very courageous and stood with them. So if she didn't do anything good besides being a good fever nurse, there at the time of her death, all the obituaries said that she's literally saved thousands of people's lives throughout her life as a fever nurse. Next. This is the turning basin that I just showed you on the map. Next. This is the municipal jail before it was torn down. And this is where she had her great parties on the 23rd of June. She had a great party at Lake Pontchartrain near that lighthouse, and the lighthouse actually still exists. It's near UNO campus. It just went through the news. It's now on sand on the beach, but it's still there. And from somewhere near that, she had a big John the Baptist ceremony that happens always at the 23rd of June. It more or less collides with the summer solstice. It's a big thing throughout Europe, and it's a big thing in Haitian voodoo as well. And it was a big thing in New Orleans in the 19th century. So she said, they say that during Reconstruction in the 1870s, when voodoo was no longer oppressed, she attracted 7,000 of people to her ceremony, so we don't know. The records are inconclusive, but at least we have the stories. Next. That's the last image of her, and that's for sure not accurate. It was made 5 years after her death, and you can see this is the stereotype of the old hag, one of the stereotypes of the European witch, and this is the stereotype of the young seductress. She looks like a Greek goddess. So these two have no African features. So we know for sure this has nothing to do with Marie Laveaux. And that became one of the most famous images of her, of course, from the 1830s to from the 1880s on. Next, please. This is her death record, and you see here, she's supposed to have been 98 years old. I don't know where that comes from. She was barely 80. She was not quite 80 yet. But apparently she exponentially aged, because up to her 70s, she was always depicted as younger. But from her late 70s, suddenly every year they mentioned her age, but it went up to 98, I'm sorry. Next. So here you see that the formation, if ever there was an authentic image, it would have been that one. And that's a pretty lady. And it's about how she was described as, you know, high yellow, which is that suddenly people associate her with the icons of European witches. Next. Then goes further. This goes one step further. She still has hair, although it looks like dreadlocks. But look at this. This is in one of the voodoo shops in the French Quarter. It becomes snakes. Ooh, next. Here's her famous tomb. This one was on a good day when everything is clean here. Yeah? And nice flowers, next. And these X marks, please don't believe that's voodoo. This is a tourist thing to do. This has absolutely nothing to do with voodoo. The story goes that if you make three X's and you knock three times and stomp three times on the floor and leave a bunch of pennies, three times three or more, then she will grant you a wish. And when you come back, you have to circle it. Do you see any circles anywhere? Yeah. So I think you get your wishes much more likely if you actually pray to her, bring her some flowers, and treat her like a respectable person. Plus this tomb, there are still living descendants of her, of this family, and this is a family tomb. So if you ever catch some of those naughty tourists, please tell them this is not why, you know, it won't get any wishes fulfilled. It's a wishing tomb similar to any of the other devotional sites of the city. Just like people came to her through a lifetime and thought that she could do miracles and she could help people. Although she herself always said when some miracle was performed, she said, "Do not thank me, thank God, because it's God who made the miracle." So she always said that. That's why the Catholic Church never interfered with her. But people come to her tomb, and I know many people who had spectacular success with terminal illnesses, no money, suddenly they win in the lottery. So whether it's their faith that brings what they want to bring, or whether it's the spirit of Novi Laveaux, nobody can tell. Ultimately, it's always God who brings, fulfills wishes, right? But that's what the story of that tomb is. You see again the vilification. This is an older image of it, and this is how it may have looked, but this is the depiction of one of the early books by Robert Tallon. This is actually the cover of one of, I think, of Gamboyaya, and it shows, you know, it had, at some point, it had all these flower things. So apparently, in earlier years, people just bought her flowers, and more flowers. But here you already see, ooh, you know, the spirit comes out and gonna get you, evil. Next. So let's look into voodoo and jazz. How does that work? Next. Here we have Jelly Roll. Voodoo and jazz is in many ways a direct connection. If you know anything about Haitian music and the Haitian drumming, and then you hear early jazz, you think it's identical, the same rhythms. So there was definitely a direct connection with the African rhythms. They were common in Haiti, in Cuba, and in New Orleans. And then here in New Orleans, it became the birthplace of jazz because after the Civil War, we were full of immigrants from Europe, from especially Germany, Italy and Ireland, and the Central Europeans, the Germans, the Dutch, the Belgians, they adored their brass instruments and they introduced them here, but they didn't have those rhythms. And as Duke Ellington always says, it don't mean a thing if we ain't got that swing, right? So building a saxophone doesn't mean you know jazz. So we became the birthplace of jazz, but Mr. Jelly Roll, who you see in the middle, actually was the product of a voodoo family. His godmother, they say, made a pact with the devil, I don't know about that, but she definitely was in charge of making him the star that he became because his parents did not want him to become a musician. So a similar story is about all of our early jazz people, that only their spiritual protection and little charms or whoever voodoo was around helped them, got them where they want. Well, why? Because, you know, Jim Crow was nothing nice to be African-American. You were constantly at risk. You were constantly, you know, subject to all kinds of problems on the road, and being an African-American musician who's on the road was really at risk to illnesses, to not getting proper care, to being stressed out, and to just routine problems with the police as an African-American. So they needed special protection. No wonder they resorted to voodoo. Whether it worked or not, I don't know. It didn't work for a Buddy Bolden. Buddy Bolden was messing with women, and one of them is said to put a hex on him. He ended up for the next 30 years in mental illness. Died in a mental facility. Voodoo worked, I guess, yeah. So he got Jelly Roll, whose godmother was a very famous voodoo queen. Next. So voodoo in New Orleans today, right? You want to know what's going on now? Let's go next. We have everywhere in the French Quarter these voodoo sets with the doll, right? We paint it. We have it for everything, you know? Whether you want to kill an enemy, whether you want to heal heart disease, or whether you want to just lose weight. We have a voodoo kit for that, you know? For just about anything. Where does it come from? Well, you'd be surprised. Charms with a doll and a pin come from the Alps, not from Africa. But of course, creative Africans put anything to use. These voodoo dolls did exist in New Orleans, and anyone was using them who wanted to. But they're just kind of like a symbol that you focus your energy to, or what you want to achieve next. The mojo bag, I already told you, the mojo bag, a little flannel bag with whatever you put in there. You know, depending on the outcome, what you want to achieve with the mojo, you put stuff in there, you know, like for protection, for love, for cursing someone, anything you can do with it. But you have to put the right stuff in it, you have to put the right prayers on it, and you have to dress it. So something has to come on it, like an alcohol, a perfume, some substance has to come on it, and a prayer to charge it. This is nothing by itself. This is just a flannel bag with some strange stuff inside. But a prayer will turn it into a mojo bag. Mojo is the Anglo word. Gwigwi is our word, and the word Gwigwi does not exist in Haiti, which is already an indication that our, you know, most common word for voodoo is not Haitian at all. That's sure already an indication that we have a different tradition. So Gwigwi comes from our colonial time and comes from the Senegambian people. Next. Okay. Oh wait, well, this is just a few recipes of our famous voodoo. So you know, anything is in there. Of course, very often the High John, the Conquer Hood, that's kind of the master of all voodoo in New Orleans. Rabbit's foot, dragon's blood oil, you know. Our mojo beans, we saw them earlier. Devil's shoestring, that's a plant. You know, all kind of interesting things going there. A black cat charm, wow, lodestone. That's a magnetic stone. You can replace it with a magnet. It's for attracting charms. Right. These charms, actually, you can still buy them. We have lots of stores for it. Next. The prices would be higher. This is like $18. No way. They cost more now. Okay. Now, this is one from West Africa. That's actually from Central Africa. This is the Congolese, Nkisi. So the way we make our charms are very much like in the Congo. This is the Congolese one. But again, the Senegambians and the Congolese have very similar charms. So it was interesting for me that the two people that had the largest influence on our Africanization actually had very similar practices.